Grills, pennants, Cuban links, VVS, all terms you'll hear a rapper use at least once when describing their jewelry box.
This right here I got from Elliot. He ain't do me too bad. It's like 45. It's just a regular Cuban iced out. It's white.
YWR, this the only one of these pennants on his table that I bought. No, I bought that one too.
This chain, I got this from Wafi. The picture can spin around. This is like, initially when I came the first time, I had a chain like this. It was a memory pendant that I got from Wafi for like 40,000.
Favorite piece is probably this right here. Lately, I've been into the more like dainty stuff.
Hip hop fashion, especially the gemstones and medals adorned by rappers, have become a staple within the culture. An MC's first pendant, a rite of passage. But in the Democratic Republic of Congo, Sierra Leone, and other African regions, laborers and activists have called out the human rights violations and the extraction of these jewels and medals. Undeterred by these facts, hip-hop culture continues to deck itself with diamonds and gold. Is this procurement just part of our cultural essence, or are we as complicit in the modern-day enslavement of mainland Africans?
Celebrate the glamour of Elizabeth Taylor and her timeless fragrance, White Diamonds. Forever. A diamond is forever, De Beers.
The fixation with diamonds is not just a hip-hop thing. The masses have been enamored with this pure carbon mineral since the mid-1900s.
Today, the purchase of a diamond engagement ring to signify relationships milestone is standard practice, well, at least in the global north. But a few decades ago, this norm was quite unusual, until the arrival of the South African-British cartel, the De Beers Diamond Consortium.
On a hill in Johannesburg, South Africa, is the private estate of the family that controls the diamond empire. These are the Oppenheimers. In two generations, they have built one of the most powerful industrial cartels of the 20th century.
The cartel was funded by English colonialist Cecil Rhodes after the discovery of diamonds in the then British colony of South Africa. After creating his diamond syndicate to monopolize the world's diamond industry, Ernest Oppenheimer of the Anglo-American Corporation would step in. Oppenheimer brought a seat on De Beers' board in 1926 and became a chairman in 1929. Since then, the De Beers Corporation has largely been kept within the Oppenheimer family. In the 1940s, through the help of the American Advertising Agency, N.W. Ayer & Son, the slogan, "A diamond is forever," was coined for the De Beers, establishing and solidifying the emotional link with the purchase of diamonds.
When you give a solitaire, you say more, and you say it with more brilliance, more depth, more fire. The Diamond Solitaire. A diamond is forever. De Beers.
By associating diamonds with love, the De Beers was able to widen its selling market to the middle classes, not only convincing consumers to buy diamonds for every significant milestone, but to hoard them and to never really resell them either.
My man, what'd you drop today? You get some new jewelry?
Quarter million.
Whoa, how much is that, man? Look at the stacks.
Yeah, bitch, quarter million.
What?
TMZ?
Yeah, bro, look at that. You walk around with that giant stack of money, bro?
Yeah, giant stack, big old stack, knock your head off.
The hand may be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend.
The marketing campaign moved beyond print and commercial ads. Soon after, the De Beers courted large Hollywood studios for their diamonds to appear on screen. Films are essential parts of media propaganda and push for narratives much more effectively. Movie publicist Maggie Ettinger was contracted by Ayer & Son and became a de facto diamond lobbyist for the De Beers in Hollywood, influencing the ways diamonds were portrayed in movies and how often they showed up. The 1980s or Reagan's 80s were often associated with America's love of materialism and the consumer economy.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Through Reaganomics, President Ronald Reagan advocated for tax cuts on corporations and a decrease in federal spending. The supply-side economics promised economic growth that would eventually trickle down to the middle and working classes, but it didn't entirely pan out that way. In Black communities, buppies, counterparts to yuppies, emerge, upwardly mobile Black professionals living in or near urban areas. Their presence affected Black cinema as the switch was made from Black exploitation films of the 70s to more nuanced film narratives like Spike Lee's She's Gotta Have It or Eddie Murphy's Coming to America. In parallel to this economic wave, Black Americans living in poverty rose significantly. The crack epidemic and Reagan's disinvestment in key welfare programs brought blight to a lot of Black communities. All of these changes, good or bad, affected the landscape of hip-hop, particularly how rappers looked. With the 80s came MTV and music videos, and artists' aesthetics such as style and demeanor, especially music videos, took center. In hip-hop, fashion and jewelry were not only means to express oneself, but also stand out amongst the burgeoning and competitive genre. In 1982, Harlem designer Dapper Dan opened his boutique on 125th Street, creating logo mania with luxury fashion clothing. His clientele, drug lords and rap stars. Dookie ropes, gold and supersized braided chains became a status symbol in hip-hop. From there, the game's jewelry just got bigger and flashier, but no one did it like Slick Rick.
Slick Rick, he is the, Rick is the ruler. I mean, he probably elevated the big pieces like no other at that time, especially in juxtaposition to a lot of the conscious rappers who were wearing, Pan-African medallions, leather medallions and stuff like that, who weren't wearing gold and diamonds. My name is Gabriel Allan Tolliver. I am a content creator across media platforms, writer, producer, director, author, journalist. I'm also an entrepreneur.
Oliver co-wrote Bling, the hip-hop jewelry book, with hip-hop attorney and respected hip-hop head Reggie Osei in 2006. Osei passed away from colon cancer in 2017.
Wow. Reggie Osei and I met through a mutual friend probably back in 1990. Yeah, maybe around 1990. And at that time, he was a music business attorney. And so I always used to go up to the office and chop it up with him and his other associates about the industry. Because at that time, I also worked at MTV and stuff. Reggie was a very creative person. And he had this duality of business because he was a music business attorney. So there was a part of him that was very analytical. And then there was this sort of like free form creative vibe about him. I think we were motivated because it hadn't been done before. And I think at that time, for somebody like Reg and myself, we were looking to kind of make moves within the industry and kind of identify things that weren't happening or were overlooked. There was a little bit of panic because once we kind of put together like the book treatment while I was on a job on the road. And so I would work on it with him when I got back to the hotel room. And we would work on it via phone and via email. We put together this like kind of piecemeal PowerPoint book presentation. It was especially challenging for him because at the time, I mean, he was raising four kids with his wife. And so a lot of juggling.
Let's talk about the eagle on the arm.
Yeah, no doubt. It's like
can y'all get a
pounds,
close up of this?
You know what I mean? Y'all see that, right? That's real,
whoa,
right?
You talk about a bracelet.
Yeah. It's a big bangle, right?
Woo! How wow. heavy is that?
It's like 4 pounds.
All right. So what does okay. it all represent? What's that mean?
It's like, yo, this is the W, man.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, no question. Also, you know, it's like, you know, it's real right there. You know what I mean?
Now, do you Word switch out. Arms so that, like, you don't get stronger in this arm than
Nah, because I be hitting the gym, so you know it's like I find a way to balance it out. You know what I mean?
And what's on the piece here? We can't forget about this.
Yeah.
Okay, this
my man right here.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Ghostface Killer from Wu-Tang, who, you know, to me was like elevated it just as much as Rick.
Ghostface Killer, member of the 90s hip hop collective Wu-Tang Clan, reportedly dropped six figures on his infamous 4-pound eagle bracelet. The South has always had an interesting twang within hip hop culture. At first widely overlooked in the game, the region's dominance and rise to power began in the late 90s and early 2000s.
This is Rick. And then you had the hip hop artists from the South, who I feel in particular elevated the grill game, not just like, you know, gold grills, but diamond encrusted grills and designs. And, you know, you had Cash Money, the whole Cash Money crew, Master P. And then visually you had this art and design studio called Pen and Pixel at that time. I think they might have morphed into something called AKA Studios or something, but Pen and Pixel, I mean, they got with Master P and they created the visual language of bling and all these album covers that everybody started to copy and emulate, particularly mostly down South.
What? He's a comedian. What? Tell your favorite rapper, holla at me.
I am
no, really, nigga. No, really, nigga.
Oh,
no, really, on the come up. No, really, nigga.
Oh,
no, really, nigga.
The other time was going down South, outside Atlanta, and meeting up with Eddie Pleen, and who had originally come from New York, but went migrated down to the Atlanta area, and he is considered the creator of the grills. And it was a trip going to his strip mall shop and observing a lot of the emerging Dirty South culture that was bubbling up in and around him. He even tripped out for Reg and I was. I remember there were a bunch of white kids that rolled up to Eddie's spot, and they were all grilled out. And, you know, it wasn't like you didn't see anybody, you know, who happened to be white into hip hop or anything of that nature, but just seeing the grills being rocked by, you know, regular white kids growing up around, you know, the Dirty South hip hop culture. That was a little bit of a shock for Reg per se and myself in a way.
I'm not going to comment on some sensationalist magazine article.
In 2011, the Oppenheimer family finally lost its majority stake in the De Beers Corporation. Critically, some wouldn't classify the deal as a loss, since the Oppenheimer family sold its stake for around £3 billion, roughly around $5 billion. As of 2022, the De Beers monopoly in the global diamond industry has weakened, second in the world to Russian diamond mining conglomerate Alrosa, and producing an estimated 30% of the global diamond production market share.
We're rafters.
The De Beers Centennial Reign is a simple story, the pursuit of capitalism at any cost. End goal was always a monopoly that would lead to higher profits. Cecil Rhodes emigrated to South Africa in the mid-1800s after the discovery of diamonds.
The carbon mineral had already surfaced and mined in India, but Africa was a new and bountiful frontier, especially for the colonial elite. Initially, Rhodes acquired as much mining rights as he could and then acquired the De Beers farm from Dutch landowners, now on the site of the Kimberley mine. Rhodes' acquisition of diamond mines in South Africa continued after his political power strengthened, serving as prime minister in 1890. The De Beers acquisition and use of black indigenous laborers were the underpinnings of the country's apartheid state in the 20th century.
Compound system. Miners were virtual prisoners unable to leave until their contracts were up. They made use of the pass laws. Once released from the compounds, miners had no free movement in the country.
Arguably, Rhodes' political career was solely motivated for the continued indentured servitude of black indigenous populations. Through racist laws and monitoring, these indigenous populations were forcibly removed from their lands. Many knew the subpar and dangerous conditions of mining labor. Black South Africans had no choice but to work. Rhodes' Franchise and Ballot Act of 1892 and the Glenn Gray Act of 1894 enforced racial segregation of black and white South Africans. Most importantly, it supplied Rhodes with consistent black labor.
After he died in 1902, Rhodes' influence and legacy continue in the corporate side of the De Beers.
To control the supply, demand, and cost of diamonds, the De Beers enacted ruthless business strategies at all costs. In 2005, the De Beers Corporation settled an antitrust class action lawsuit with the United States for an estimated $300 million. The United States government charged that the De Beers conspired to monopolize the sale of rough diamonds in the states, manipulating the market to their liking and at their convenience. In the Democratic Republic of Congo, the De Beers courted then-President Mobutu Sese Seko during his dictatorship. Located in Central Africa, the Congo is rich in natural resources such as copper, oil, and gold. The country has the largest cobalt reserves in the world and top five globally for diamond production. Mobutu's kleptocratic government supplied him, his family, and friends with riches through the corrupt sale of these natural resources. Today, Congolese miners who work to extract the country's mineral resources do so under dire conditions. Homes displaced for the construction of mines and exposed to toxic materials at all times. All for a little to nothing wage and Apple's latest product launch.
Today, we're introducing three revolutionary products of this class.
As 2003, as a means to prevent the sale of conflict diamonds, De Beers co-signed the Kimberley process. The certification scheme established by a United Nations resolution to ensure the decrease of conflict diamonds in the global market has had underwhelming results.
Our top story. As we all know, Congress recently approved paying over $1 trillion to African Americans as reparations for slavery. Well, today, the first checks were sent out. Wendy Mullen is standing by live in Queens with more. Wendy?
Thanks, Chuck. We're standing here in front of the Olympic liquor store in Queens, where scores of African Americans have been lined up for hours. We spoke to a few of them earlier. Ladies, may we get a word?
Hide the money, y'all. There's poor people around.
And I personally feel we live in an age of psychotic capitalism where, you know, it's never enough. And somebody always has to get, unfortunately, exploited for somebody else to make a profit. And I think when it comes to the jewelry and diamonds and stuff like that, you know, it really depends on the integrity of the jeweler.
Is hip-hop's infatuation with gold and diamonds just part of our cultural essence, or are we as complicit in the modern exploitation of mainland Africans?
When we really want to talk about original bling, and we didn't even touch upon that, but, you know, we can look to Ghana or Benin. I mean, the Ghanaians with their, that's the original bling. I mean, without question. I mean, and then that goes back to that DNA encoded in, you know, in the diaspora of folks. But I mean.
Ah.
This has been a very special episode of The Griots. I hope to see you soon. Until next time.